Got the PDF, yes. As in everybody got the hard copy of the notes? Yeah? Okay. Hey, Sean. The session is in recording. We'll get started. Why don't we just start off with a word of prayer, shall we? Yeah. Father, we look to you this morning. Lord, we give you thanks. We give you glory. Give you all the honor. Thank you for this wonderful privilege that we have to learn from your word, God. You are good. I pray that Holy Spirit, you will come and teach us. You would come and fill us with your presence, more of you, God. Lord, we just don't want to have a head knowledge or an intellectual understanding of what praise and worship is. God, we want to experience you. We want to encounter you. That is the desires of our heart. And so we submit and surrender everything unto you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Are you guys excited to start learning about praise and worship? Anyone who is not excited, put your hands up. Liars. No, I'm just kidding. great. How many of you guys online are excited? If you are excited, just say yay.
Okay. Yay.
Good, good, good. Well, this topic is very dear to my heart. So there was a time in my life where it was about 2005, I think, 2004, 2005. So I failed in my 12th standard. In Karnataka, we call it second PUC, in mathematics. So as you know, I was not good at mathematics, right? And then you know how our society is. If you fail in a subject, they put a label over you and say you're a failure. They'll start talking about you. You know, it's like, oh, you're good for nothing, useless fellow, go find work somewhere and whatnot. So I found myself at the lowest point of my life in that season. Like, low means I thought I lost all hope, right? Like zero hope, no help. I was ashamed to look at my parents because I was guilty thinking I failed them because they paid for my education, right? They paid the fees, and I was at my lowest point. Yeah. But it was in that moment, I don't know what led me to Isaiah chapter 54. I had never read the book of Isaiah before. I didn't know there was a book called Isaiah until then in the Bible. But I don't know what else to do. So I might as well read the Bible. You know, I started flipping. And by the way, this is the same Bible that I read back then. Same Bible as in, you know, it's not a different Bible, but a different version. So it was at that point, all I knew to do was sing and worship. Like, that's all I knew to do, right? I didn't know what else to do. I did not have any other skill like painting or, bless you. I did not paint. I could not paint. There was no computer program. I did not have any other skill. Right? You with me? So the only thing I knew to do, I could do, was worship. And I still remember that moment in my room where I sat and thought, okay, there is no hope. You know. But then God speaking to me through His Word, and this. One aspect of worship, that is singing or playing an instrument, got me through the most darkest season of my life. Now it's how many years ago? It's almost 18 years ago. So I was 18 years younger, right? So it happened a long time ago. So this subject is not just an intellect thing for me. It's very real. It's one of those things that got me through the darkest season. So I am very excited about sharing, teaching what I have learned. I don't know everything about the subject. So just so you know, I don't know you know, if I say I don't know to your questions, don't hate me, right? When I say I don't know, I really don't know. So, but then I'm excited about sharing everything that I've learned in the last 18 years or so with you guys and with you all online, wherever you are, whichever part of India you're joining us from. So once again, hi. Let's get started, okay? What is worship? What is your understanding of worship? It's a classic question everybody asks. I've been in hundreds of worship workshops, and the first question they all ask is, what is worship according to you? So I'm going to start with the same thing. Feel free to type your answers in the chat section, guys. And until then, let me hear from my friends here. That's my support. Worship. What, according to you, is worship? Glorifying God. Okay. Vijay. Giving thanks to God. Okay, class is over. You all have passed in this exam. We don't need to have this class. Everybody's giving right answers. Just kidding. Glorifying God. Yeah, thanks, Krisha. Awesome. Okay, anybody else? Surrender. Okay. What is worship in Hindi? I'm Aradhana. Tamil, Aradhanai. Nay. You just add a little bit of ghee in it and Aradhana, Aradhanai. Okay. Any other language that we have here? Yes. Yes, please. Aradhana. Yeah, okay, I think we get an idea. Yeah, so what is Aradhana? What does it mean for you, Aradhana? What is it? What's the first thing that comes to your mind? Adoring God. Viku, your classmate says adoring God. Okay. Okay. Giving ourselves to God. You're somewhat in line with surrender. Yeah, yeah. Loving God. Okay, Chira. Polo bhai. Francis, sorry, Rin, yeah, no, yeah. Bring yourself down, surrender, yeah, awesome, yeah. Relationship with God, Prabhu from online says, relationship with God, how true is that? Connecting with God, another answer, yeah, fantastic. Sean, what do you think? You have you played this game, you know, with your friends? Even if this is for also for the guys online. With my friends, we kind of play this game. Okay, we use a word. We give you a word or name. You have to say the first thing that comes to your mind, like rapid fire round. If you take time to say, that means you have a problem with that person. Like for example. I say, Karen, what's the first thing that comes to your mind when I say Rin? And if you take more than 2 seconds, that means you've got a problem with Rin. Yeah. Francis, what do you think of Sean? Out to, okay, taking time. That means he's got a problem. No, I'm just kidding. So worship is everything what you've said. We can't really go wrong in our definition in worship. We can't go wrong in what our understanding. There is no right answer or wrong answer, right? What your understanding of worship is, what it is. But let's dive into it a little bit. If you have your notes with you, just look into our notes. And guys online, please feel free to refer to your PDF. So the first thing you will see right on top, okay, the dictionary. We have to refer to the dictionary, isn't it? The dictionary defines worship as the act, okay? You can underline the word act, or in your PDF you can highlight the word act, okay? So the dictionary defines the word act, okay? We get the word action. Oh, I hear the director say, action! Lights, camera, and action. That's what's happening, right? That means you have to start doing something, right? It's a verb. right? Verb is what you do something. It's an action. That means you can't say, I worship you and not do anything. Right? So the first thing of what we need to understand is the dictionary defines worship as the act, an action of expressing love. You said, right? Expressing. What does expressing mean? You show. Yes? Express means you show. Okay? If I tell my wife that I love her, but I don't do anything to express my love, one is she let me know that I'm not expressing. Okay, but then second thing is I don't really mean what I'm saying, isn't it? Yes or no? Yes or no? Guys, yes or no? Yeah. Right, so first thing is worship is an act of expressing love. It is adoration, respect and honor for someone or something. Okay, it's very important. Respect and honor for someone or something. Why is something over there? Someone is understandable, but something, a thing. This is a thing. It's a thing, isn't it? Laptop is a thing. Right? That means it is possible that you and I can express our love, our adoration, our respect and honor for a thing. Yes? Do you guys agree? Yeah, guys online, do you agree? Rohit, Nandan, what do you think? It is possible for us to express our love, adoration, worship someone, something, isn't it? So everybody worships. Right, we get this word worship from an ancient Greek word called worth-ship. Okay, worth. What's the meaning? What's the Hindi word for worth? Worthy. Worthy. Yogya. Yeah, I think that's. Yeah, yogya. Malayalam. Tamil. Worthy. A little louder. Okay. Okay. Anybody else online? Another language, the meaning of worthy, not meaning, what do you say? Kannada? Yogya. Same. Anybody else knows Kannada here? Same. Okay. So we derive this word worship from the old ancient Greek word called worth-ship. That means you will honor someone if you find that person is yogya, worthy, right? Or something even, right? We use this word worthy for in so many things. We say, is that person, is Francis trustworthy? What is the meaning of that? Is Vijay trustworthy? That means, is he worthy of my trust? Yes? Like that, there are so many words that we can, you know, assign worthy to. Is this guitar worthy of my worship? Is this laptop worthy of my worship? Is this phone, whatever, right? Thing, someone, or any person that you love, your best friend or your whoever. Right, so the question comes is this thing or someone worthy of my worship? Okay, let's move on. So in the notes it says, as humans, we are all designed to worship, whether we realize it or not, to be totally in awe of something or someone, so as to give ourselves completely over and be greatly influenced by that something or someone. Okay, look at that words. Some of your answers are in that. It says, to be totally in awe of something or someone as to give ourselves completely. Some of you said surrender, right? To just give complete control. And so what it's saying is that we were designed to worship. We were made to worship. God created you and me to worship. To adore something, it's in our DNA. It's in our blood. Aradhana, right? to do that is to behold is in our DNA. And so that's why we have this tendency to worship a thing, or someone or something. Okay. But later on, as we go on, we'll study the true worship, false worship, all of that a little later. Right? But there are some questions down there and I want to ask you this. So the church talks about worship and spends time and effort in worship. Why do we have to have this course on praise and worship? Why do we have to sing songs and have this time of worship in our Sunday service? A simple question, is worship the time spent singing? Is worship the time spent singing? Is singing worship? Guys, what do you think online? I see the answers are changing now. It's like what is worship time spent singing? Give me an answer, give it properly, loud and proud. A little loudly. Yeah, okay. So we have a few answers online. Yeah. So it's not a tricky question. So is worship the time spent singing? Yeah. It partially is. Is it the only thing of worship? What do you say for singing in Hindi? Gana. To sing, what is it? Gana, gana. Sing, sing. What is gana? What, I've heard some Hindi words. Gana, bajao. Okay, I'm not going to attempt speaking in Hindi. So, yeah. Thanks, Jachin. I see your answers. Yeah. Right, so, worship, yes, singing is a part of it. It's not the only thing, but it is an aspect of worship. Okay, another question that's in your notes is worship a genre of music? A genre, matlab, what do you say? Different styles of worship, like classic rock, Indian classical, Carnatic, funk, pop, jazz. Is worship a genre of music? I come to your church. Oh, in your church, you play this kind of music. In our church, we play different kind of music. So is that worship? So what we need to understand, okay, simple, for us to move on very quickly, is singing and music are tools, are instruments. Right, it's a tool that you use to express. We go back to the first definition, right? We express our love, we express our adoration, our honor and respect in singing, and we express the same thing with while playing an instrument and whatnot. But it's not the only aspect of worship. But the reason I ask that question is, I think somewhere, somehow, we've missed the focus of what worship is. And we started using certain definitions like this in your notes, if you look very carefully. Okay. By the third song, I was really worshiping. Have you heard someone say that? By the third song, I was worshiping, brother. I was into it. First two songs, I was just, you know. That man, he's not lifting up his hands. Have you heard anyone say that, or have you made that statement? Have you made that? Have you said it? Okay. Hello? Who's speaking? Okay, so these are just some of the familiar comments that we're going to run through, okay? The next thing over there. Worship gets me to a place where I don't have to think about anything. Worship gets me to a place where I don't have to think about anything. I've heard people say this, but where I would disagree is Bible says, love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind. If you're not thinking, then who are you worshiping? What are you worshiping? You get what I'm saying? Talk to me. You guys with me online? Yeah. Evangel. Will there be worship at the meeting? This is a question I've been asked. Will there be worship at this Christian meeting? Okay. The question is of who or what? Okay. You see how the definition has changed. We've kind of taken this thing called worship and put it in a flask and say, because only flask is there. We put it in a flask. Okay, this is what worship is. Singing, dancing, playing an instrument is only worship. Everything outside of the flask is not worship. Okay, I'm talking the flask because I have a flask, guys. I don't have a box. So, and another definition, what people usually say is, with only 20 minutes, we really didn't have time to worship. We had 20 minutes this morning, isn't it? They led worship for 20 minutes. So can we say, with only 20 minutes, we didn't have time to worship? What does that mean? So are you telling me that 20 minutes is not enough to worship God? Beast minute, not enough? I don't know, beast. Guys, what do you think online? Yeah, Krisha, have you heard some of these statements, Prabhu? Yeah. Okay, let's just move on very quickly. Okay. Let's come down to page, the next page on PDF. It's page 3. But I've put together some definitions of worship, what people have said in the past. Okay. It's called defining worship. The next page. Are you guys with me? Any questions? Any thoughts? Sleepy? Okay, so first definition there is by Dutch humanist Desiderius Erasmus. Okay, can everybody see that? Yeah, you're there? The first definition, it's by a Dutch humanist called Desiderius Erasmus. I put this one in because I like his name. Okay, Desiderius Erasmus. Have you seen this movie Gladiator? No? Okay, we don't see movies. Oh, we are Bible college students. Okay, let's move on. Okay. Okay, if you haven't seen Gladiator, well, you haven't seen it. But okay, there's a moment where he lifts off his helmet and he says, my name is Maximus Decimus Meridius. And it's like a coolest moment. Okay, I was like, that's why I thought, okay. So, well, this guy's got a cool name, Desiderius Erasmus. Okay, so this is what he says. Just one thing. Every definition is dangerous. Every definition is dangerous. What is the meaning of a definition? What do you say definition in another language, Hindi, or describing something? Meaning, like using matlab, no? Definition. Because all of this is very important, guys. The reason I'm asking so many questions is I want you to think. Okay, I don't want to stand here for 2 hours and just blah, 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 and then go away. Yes? Okay, so he says every definition is dangerous. Then he goes on to say, that may explain why when we try to define a word simply and precisely, we often end up missing significant aspects of the word we are defining. Attempts at explaining worship as love or intimacy or relationship say something true, but end up leaving out more than more than they contribute to our understanding of worship. Okay, so when we express worship is surrender, worship is love, worship is this, worship is that, it's all true. But then a challenge arises if we just label worship as just that one word, because you're missing out on so many other things. Right? So it simply says every definition is dangerous. But the next thing is my favorite, the second one. It says, acknowledging that someone or something else is greater, worth more, and by consequence, to be obeyed, feared, and adored. Worship is a sign that in giving myself completely to someone or something, I want to be mastered by it. Okay, so that's from the book called Music Through the Eyes of Faith. The author is Harold Best. Okay. Can everybody see that? Yes. So I just want to read that one more time. Please follow along. It says, acknowledging. What does acknowledging mean? What does acknowledge mean? You just, so for example, I walked in to this class, right? This is a classroom. And if I did not say good morning, nothing, I pretend like y'all are not there at all. Am I acknowledging your presence? Right? So simply saying, okay, so if someone is here, you're saying, oh, hey, hi, how are you doing? By just doing that, I am acknowledging that there is this person here. Are you with me? Yeah? So that's what acknowledging that someone or something else is greater. So when you say when you're worshiping a thing, or you know, besides God, or when you're worshiping, you know, this we live in a culture of hero worshiping happens, right? There is a very thin gap between worship and honor. Okay, what is honor? There's a very thin, like this is a big gap, okay? There's a very thin line between worship and, everybody say honor? Honor, okay? Sometimes we cross that line. Bible says it's a good thing to honor another person, right? But we cross that line of honor and we begin to worship, and we do that a lot in India. We do that a lot in India. We begin to worship our pastors. We begin to worship our leaders. Honoring them is not wrong. Huh? Oh, Taliba! You know, Taliba is a Tamil word. Okay, so, but it's very carefully, just look at the definition one more time. Acknowledging that someone or something else is greater. Are you acknowledging that God is worthy and God is great in your life? Are you doing that? Is that a question you need to ask yourself? And what happens by acknowledging that someone is greater and worth more? As a result of that, you start obeying that person. Right? You start obeying. You start giving your worship to that person, right? Completely, a total surrender. Let's move on quickly. So worship is the believer's response to all that they are. Mind, emotions, will, body, to what God is and says and does. Okay, worship is the believer's response. Notice that. Okay, we are all called believers, right? We are believers because we believe in our Lord Jesus Christ. We've accepted Lord Jesus as our personal Lord and Savior. Who has not? Please put your hands up. Okay, so we are all believers. But the next word after believer, what is that word? What is the word after believers? Response. Everybody say response. You are responding or reacting, right? You are acknowledging. So worship is the believer's response of all that they are. That's a mind, emotions, will, and body. What are you responding to? You are responding to what God is and says and does. Okay, that's from another beautiful book you can read. Okay, let's move on quickly. Definition number four. All right, you guys online, are you all following? Are you with me? I hope I'm going slow enough. If I'm going a little fast, please let me know. But are you guys with me? Yeah, please say yes. Okay. Sweet, thank you. Great, so definition number four, David Peterson, in his book called Engaging with God, he says, worship of the living and true God is essentially an engagement with Him on the terms that He proposes and in the way that He alone makes it possible. Worship of the living and true God is essentially an engagement with God on the terms that He proposes in the way that He alone makes possible. It's very interesting that it says, okay, worship is relationship with God. We are engaging with Him. We are talking with Him and whatnot. But what is interesting in his book, what he says is, all of that is worship. It's an engagement with Him, but it is on the terms that He says. Right? What does that mean? Terms on that He says. That means we don't tell God that I'm going to worship you like this. He tells you how you are to worship Him. Yes or no? Hey, please talk, guys. What is this? Morning, y'all are like, oh. Yeah. So most of the time, that's how we behave. It's like, okay, this is how I'm going to worship God. I tell Him, I go to Him and tell, okay, this is how I'm going to worship you. Okay. But in all truth, is that worship is His idea, and He tells us, He teaches us how to worship. Yeah. The last definition, the fifth one, says worship is the activity of the new life of a believer in which recognizing the fullness of the Godhead as it is revealed in the person of Jesus Christ and His mighty redemptive acts, He seeks by the power of the Holy Spirit to render the living, to giving God the glory, honor, and submission which are His due. It's from another book called O Come, Let Us Worship. Okay, the first three words, first four at least, so worship is the activity. That means, again, action is involved. Worship is you doing it, okay? Worship is the act. You can underline it, highlight it. Worship is the activity, what? Of the new life of a believer in which, this is the response, recognizing the fullness of the Godhead as it is revealed in the person of Jesus Christ. It's simply, it's just acknowledging that Jesus is your Lord and Savior, simple as that, is worship. Just telling God, you are amazing, you are worthy, you deserve all my praise, you deserve all my worship, you deserve all my love, you deserve all 100% attention, 100% focus. You deserve it all because nothing else deserves my affection, my devotion. You just saying that is worship. You don't have to be able to sing well. That is one aspect of worship which is important. Okay, because you don't want anybody singing off tune. But that's not the only thing. But can we just pause? Okay, even people online, can we just pause? Ask yourself this question. How many times in a day do you tell Him that you love Him? We tend to get very busy, isn't it? Especially people in ministry and people studying about ministry. Usually, ministry, 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 brother, ministry, 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 ministry. But we forget, why are we doing this? And for who is the person behind it? Right? It's like, you give more important to the gift than the giver. Gift is important, but gift comes from a giver, isn't it? We have this life. We can breathe. There is air in my lungs. Yes or no? Yeah? Who gave this? And if I don't take a couple of minutes to say, I love you, That is worship. As simple as that. Right. There's this book called Good Morning, Holy Spirit by Benny Hinn. The first thing that he says when he wakes up from sleep, he said, "Good morning, Holy Spirit." Something as simple as that is expressing your love, isn't it? Yes or no, guys? What do you think? Yeah. And the question that I really want you to think is, how many times in a day do you actually express your love, your affection? Affection is a beautiful word, affection and adoration. Affection and adoration. You know what adoration is? In a very simple thing, I apologize for using an example of my son. I have a four-year-old son. So what he does is, when I carry him and whatnot, two things. Okay, it's very interesting. If he's asking me a question and I'm looking at my phone or responding to an email or whatnot, and if I answer him without looking at him, he says, "Dada, look at me. Look at me." Right? And so that contact, and then there are times when you carry a child, I'm sure we've all carried a kid, a child, right? And they hold your face like this. And they start pulling your beard and whatnot, you know. Worship is childlike. It's as simple. We have complicated it. Are you with me, guys? Right? If I'm complicating the subject of worship, that means I'm failing you as a teacher. Worship is so simple. It's childlike. It's just holding a father's face and say, "I love you." That's it. Yeah, is it too hard? Right. When we realize what Jesus has done for us, it doesn't become very hard for us to express, to act, like the definition says, right? To respond to what he's saying. Isn't it? Okay, all right, let's move on very quickly to the next definition. It's one of my favorite definitions, and we are going to break that definition down, okay? Okay, everyone who is sleeping, say amen. Everybody who is not having fun, say amen. So that means everybody is having fun. Everybody is having a good time. Hey, what about you guys online? Are you with me? Yeah, cool. Okay, thanks, Krisha. Sweet. Let's look at the definition by Bob Coughlin in your notes, okay? And I want you to follow along with me, because we're going to break that down, okay? Bob Coughlin says, Christian worship, okay? Christian worship is the response of God's redeemed people to his self-revelation that exalts God's glory in Christ in our minds, affections, and wills in the power of the Holy Spirit. Very quickly, one more time. Okay, Christian worship is the response of God's redeemed people to his self-revelation that exalts God's glory in Christ in our minds, affection, wills, in the power of the Holy Spirit. Okay, so are we ready to break it down? So Christian worship, what is Christian worship? Okay, is different from every kind of worship because it has been made possible through Jesus Christ. Okay, so let's go to Revelation chapter 5. You have your Bibles with you. Let's go to Revelation chapter 5. Okay, Christian worship is different from every other kind of worship because it has been made possible through Jesus Christ. Right? Revelation chapter 5, verse 9 and 10. Let me read it for us. It talks about a song, right? And they sang a new song. It's like this: "You are worthy to take the scroll and open its seals, because you were slain. With your blood, you purchased men for God. from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests to serve our God, and they will reign on the earth. Okay, so the first step, a Christian worship, why is it different from every other kind of worship that people worship, right? You see India, you know, we will worship whatever it is. We paint a stone and we worship, right? But how is it so different? How is Christian worship different? Is because it's been made possible through what Jesus has done for us, right? Let's go. Christian worship is the response. It's the response. So God has already done something outside of us and inside of us that enables us to worship Him. We are not the initiators of worship. God is. That's very important. Okay, like one of the definitions we read before, He sets the terms. He tells us how we are to worship. We don't go to Him and tell Him, this is how I'm going to worship you, okay? Because He has already done something on the outside and also on the inside that we were made to worship. Okay, so Christian worship is a response of God's redeemed people. Everybody say redeemed. Okay, everybody online, type redeemed. Yeah, you guys. Okay, type redeemed. Okay. Christian worship is the response of God's redeemed people. So just as God delivered the nation of Israel from Egypt to worship Him, so He has redeemed us as a holy nation to declare His praise. Okay, so we're going to go from one end of the Bible to another end of the Bible. Let's all go to the book of Exodus. Exodus chapter 8. Thanks for typing it out. Your classmates online are amazing, you know that? Okay, so Exodus chapter 8, verse 1, it simply says this. Then the Lord said to Moses, go to Pharaoh and say to him, this is what the Lord says, let my people go so that they may worship me. Okay, that they may worship me. So the first thing, the first desire, the reason behind God saving Israel, bringing the Israel out of Egypt, was to, for them to worship Him. Yes or no? Yeah. God did not set them free for the sake of being free. It's like, okay, I'm going to take you from slavery, I'm going to set you free, do whatever you want to do. And that's the understanding they had, and that's what they ended up doing. It's like, okay, now we are free. I'm going to do whatever I'm going to do. But we've been redeemed. You and I, Ephesians chapter 2 says that we've been redeemed, right, from darkness into light, right? We've been purchased. We've been ransomed. We've been bought with a price, right? You were redeemed. Not because you can just go do whatever you want to do and live a life the way you want to live life, but you were redeemed to worship Him. You were redeemed to worship our Lord. Okay, let's quickly one more time go to 1 Peter all the way to the other end. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. Okay, the 1 Peter somewhere is between after the book of Genesis and before the book of Revelation. Okay. After Genesis, before Revelation, somewhere there. So when you read the Bible from the book of Genesis all the way to Revelation, there's this one recurring theme, okay, about God's heart. He keeps saying every book after book after book, He says, I am your God, you are my people. I will be your God and you will be my people. I will be your God, you will be my people. You read the book from Genesis to Revelation, That is the heart of God, is that he wants us for himself. That's how much he loves us, right? So it says one more time again in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. But you are a chosen people, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, a people belonging to God, that you may declare the praises of him who called you out of darkness into his wonderful light. Right? So we've been redeemed because he's the one who's brought us out of it. There's another scripture that I would like us to read, but what's the time? Okay, we have 3 minutes, but okay, if hey guys, if you don't mind, let's again go back to the book of Exodus. Thankful. Turning the page exercise. Okay, Exodus chapter 19. Let's go to Exodus 19 very quickly, and we'll take a break. Exodus 19. Okay, Exodus chapter 19. I just want us to reiterate one more thing. I want to read from verse 4. Okay, Exodus 19, verse 4. It says, God is saying, you yourself have seen what I did to Egypt and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. If your translation has myself, underline it. Okay. God carried them and he brought them to himself. Okay. Verse 5. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. You see the same thing in Exodus? Peter is echoing in his book, 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 9. And that's the heart of God, is that I will be your God, you will be my people, you will be my holy nation, my treasured possession, right? So that's what God's redeemed people are called to do. Christian worship, coming back to the definition, is the response of God's redeemed people with everything that we've learned so far. Okay, so what I'm going to do right now, because we can get lost in this definition, but I'm just going to stop here. We'll take a quick 10 minutes break and we'll resume the session. Is that okay? Yeah, cool. Okay. All right, guys, to you online, I'll stop the recording and take a quick 10 minutes break, and I'll see you in 10 minutes.